Warning, the following program has been rated T for truth.
You can't handle the truth!
Oh, we think you can. Welcome to the Naked Truth Report with your host, Truth Warrior and Mythbuster, Kathleen Wells. The place where we distinguish fact from fiction, where data is used to drive points home, and where Kathleen takes the position that Democrats and black politicians have destroyed black America. Welcome to the Naked Truth Report. Now, your host, Kathleen Wells.
Welcome, 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 Truth Warriors and Mythbusters. It's me, Kathleen Wells, your host of the Naked Truth Report, and I'm joined this evening by my VIP guest. I'm so excited.
Thank you.
Claire Weissman, who I met, the first time I met her was at the Reagan event. What was that, 2 or 3 weeks ago?
3 weeks ago, right?
Yeah, I attended the Sean Spicer event at the Reagan Library. And Presidential Library, and then I invited her to the pre-screening of the Dinesh D'Souza film, Death of a Nation, and she was a VIP guest, and I'm so excited. And in fact, she has an association. She's been affiliated with KRLA for a few years, right?
20 years.
For 20 years.
Yes.
Her name is Claire Weissman, and she's the president of the Weissman Method.
Right.
Tell my listeners about the Weissman Method, Claire.
We are opioid treatment specialists. We do a medical treatment for opioid dependence that is have affected this country tremendously. We're in the midst of a huge opioid crisis right now. Over 150 people are dying overdose a day.
Over 150 people are dying
of overdose.
Isn't that amazing? Tell me, how did you originally get involved with this opiate crisis? What started that?
You know, I did administration over 2 decades ago, and I slowly but surely got into the addiction field, and it took my heart. It's a subject that it's extremely important. It's horribly managed. Is patients do not get the treatment they need, and we've been suffering with drug addiction for way too long. We are United States. We do have resources to do a lot better than we do.
It's like ravaging our country.
It is.
And you were talking to me about before, where are the drugs coming from?
Correct. Especially heroin. Heroin is mostly coming from Mexico. They are our number one suppliers. And the last 10 years, our borders were open for everything and everybody. And heroin just invaded our schools, our streets, and it's killing our kids.
It's killing our kids. So, folks, when we talk about on the Naked Truth Report, when we talk about the fact that the Democratic Party, Hillary specifically, and even Bernie Sanders, they support open borders, generally speaking. So, I mean, open borders, and in fact, I had on the show Prince Abdul Ali Siraj of Afghanistan, who I would interview when I was on the Kathleen Wells show, which is a liberal show, and he talked about the fact that in Afghanistan, open borders doesn't work. So what is it about the Democratic Party that they are for open borders? That they don't, how do I want to put it, that they don't see the correlation between open borders, are people flooding into the country, are not having a secure border, and it adversely impacting American citizens in terms of jobs, but it also in terms of drugs, in terms of the influx of drugs, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Why don't Democrats get this?
I'm not sure. I think at this point, you know, if everybody in this country has known somebody that has been affected of these crises, and if they look a little further, they will know that, it would be lovely to give everybody in the world, the best experience, the privileges that we have. But there is a reason why we have borders, and it's to protect our citizens, our children. And we have paid a very, very high price for protecting others and forgetting ours.
Forgetting ours, and in fact, you're from Brazil, right?
I'm from Brazil, so I respect immigrants. I am a very, very strong patriot to United States and to believing that if we work hard here, you have every possible opportunity. And I think if you come in the right way, you can have the same opportunities I did.
So, Claire, how long have you been in the United States?
Oh, Lord. that's going to give in my age, huh? 36 years.
Oh, my gosh, you've been there. Well, you don't look a day over 30.
Oh, you're thank you.
Well, I mean, so you've been, this is home for you.
This is
for
home.
Sure.
This is definitely home.
And you have children here?
We have three children here, two boys and one girl.
Are they in the public school system? Or
they are actually between 25 and 31.
Oh, my gosh.
Yes.
I can't believe it. I thought you had little kids.
No, we have. No, I have my grandmother.
You're a grandmother?
Yes.
I can't believe it.
I have a six-month-old adorable baby girl.
So time goes by so fast.
Yes.
And you're thinking about the future of your grandchild, right?
Of course. Of course.
And what it will be like for her.
And my kids. Because what's happening with their generation is affecting them. It's not even affecting my granddaughter yet. It's truly affecting them.
How so? Tell us.
Because I think they are not seeing the opportunities. They are very negative about, I think the media has put such a negative aspect to our country that they become very depressed. And depression, anxiety causes people to self-medicate.
Oh, so tell me, why do your kids feel like, who are adults? They're adults.
Mm-hmm.
Why do they feel like their opportunities aren't great?
Because, again, I think there is such a mass media impact on negativity. I think our generation, we were patriots. We stood together for our country. We believe in the freedoms we had, and we looked around. So it's not perfect, but it's better than anything out there.
Mm-hmm.
And the only way to make it better is to appreciate what we have,
mm-hmm.
and fight to fix the things that we see, mm-hmm. that is not what we expect it to be.
Mm-hmm.
But just complaining and putting it down creates, again, the anxiety, the loneliness, the depression I see on the kids I treat.
Mm-hmm.
So I think their generation as well, because there's so much divorce,
mm-hmm.
They don't have the tools we had,
mm-hmm,
to deal with stress, to deal with emotions.
Mm-hmm.
So they end up self-medicating with drugs.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And I mean, your kids they're not kids, but adults.
Right.
Are they employed? Are they?
They are. They are.
Are they professionals? Or?
They are. We have one that is in college, and we have two. One just had a baby, so she's home right now, but mm-hmm. She was in the communications business. One is in the finance business in New York,
mm-hmm.
and the other one is in school. It took him a little longer, mm-hmm. To get there, but again, there's no exact speed for anybody.
Mm-hmm.
If you just progress, that's all we expect.
Right. And are they all three married?
No, we have one married, one that is going to get engaged soon, and one that is dating somebody for a very long time.
Okay, so at least they have love in their life.
Of course.
Well, yeah. So you're talking specifically about in terms of this depression, loneliness, anxiety, not feeling fulfilled, not focused from the clients that you treat.
No,
them.
I even see on our kids when they speak about,
kids?
Of course, when they speak about the country, when they speak about the future, when they speak about, you know, society in general, there is such a negative tone.
Really? Give me an example of like the things they say.
Just dealing with, our health in the United States, mm-hmm. The media in the United States, mm-hmm. our president.
Oh, they don't. Oh, in other words, they're not. They hate Trump.
They have to, because if they don't, they are not even accepted by their fellow friends.
By their group.
Exactly.
Oh,
who nowadays has like when the time of the elections were going on, you know, I had Trump stickers that I was going to put in my car.
Right.
And I was warned by all my kids, don't do that, don't do that. Your car's going to get keyed.
Really, really?
Yes.
Now, how old are your kids again?
Between 25 and 31.
Oh, really? Okay,
yeah.
So they're at that age where they're young adults.
And they want to be accepted by their fellow peers.
Yeah.
And you're just not allowed to have a voice anymore.
Right. Gosh, that's so, you know, you and I are like both, I'm on the tail end of the baby boomers.
Right.
So we're in that same generation.
I'm a little older than you.
Yeah, but I'm still on the tail end of the baby boomers. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, you know, I was watching a program last night, Iyanna Van Zandt. I rarely watch that. I've interviewed everybody. But I've interviewed Iyanna Van Zandt when she had her last book that came out. But for some reason, I was watching it last night, and her show is on OWN. Is that how, am I saying it right? Oprah Network or OWN Network, Iyanna Van Zandt, and she was speaking with a young woman. I think her name is Hazel E, who was on like a Hip Hop Los Angeles or something like that, a young black woman who was very, 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 she, when I say young, she was like 37. That, I mean, I know that sounds weird, but she's a young adult. She's an adult. She's not a kid. She's an adult.
Right.
She's 37, and she's on this Hip Hop LA or hip hop at Hollywood, and her name is Hazel Lee, and she was very, very negative on social media. She was so negative on social media that she got kicked off the show. So she was on with Iyanna Van Zandt to fix my life. Because she was very racial and negative. I mean, it was like, she was saying very mean and nasty things about her other cast members. Racial and prejudicial stuff, you know. And
that is unproductive. It doesn't help anybody.
But one of the things I wanted to say is Iyanna Van Zandt apologized to her. Because I think Iyanna Van Zandt is probably in her 60s, I would suspect, a baby boomer. And she apologized to this 37-year-old woman because she said, our generation, the baby boomer generation, have failed.
Mm-hmm.
The what is after the baby boomer generation? I don't know what it's called. It's not Generation X. It's not millennials. I don't know what it's called. But the ones that came after us.
Right. Our kids are the millennials.
The kids.
Yes.
Oh, the ones in their 30s and 40s. I don't know. 30s and 40s. But they're disappointed.
Yes.
So we have failed. I don't have children. But we have failed.
To make them happy?
We did something wrong.
Well, I think we tried to make them so happy that we forgot to let them be happy themselves. I think we kind of entertained them way too much.
Spoiled them.
Exactly. So they think that the country right now should give them everything, that they have the rights to have everything. And we put our work, we still do. I work 7 days a week. My husband works 12 hours a day. So we are not owned anything by anybody but ourselves.
Yeah, it's like entitlement.
Correct.
Exactly.
Correct.
Exactly. You know, I think I was pretty spoiled as a kid. I mean, when I was like a daddy's girl, but I always knew that I had to achieve.
Correct.
You know what I mean? I knew I had to achieve. I knew I had to do
correct.
Something. And more importantly, I couldn't disappoint my dad. You know, it was like so important for me. And I don't know if this was like a personal aspect to my personality, but I just wanted to achieve. I wanted to make my father so proud of me.
But I think you touch the root of the issue nowadays. I came from a very affluent home where I had everything one could ask for. But the only way I could have something is if I achieved something.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing came really for free.
Mm-hmm.
I was expected. And I think I didn't cross a certain line in my life because I was so scared to hurt my parents.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Or to let them down.
Let them down.
Correct.
I mean, the idea of me disappointing my father
correct.
Just would crush
it
me.
It would crush me.
It would correct. Crush me if I disappointed my daddy. It's like, oh, my God. If I remember as a kid, you know, when I was at UCLA, I had a Volkswagen Bug.
Mm-hmm.
And I used to, like, always get it, like, I mean, I drove too fast. And I would always get it sort of, like, in minor accidents. You know what I mean?
Right.
And this is the story I want to tell. I remember my girlfriend and I, Sean, we were, like, in our early 20s. We went to something on Sunset Boulevard, like one of those, the Roxy, it was
right.
called.
Still there.
And, you know, I parked my Volkswagen when we came out, it was towed.
Ooh.
And I said I was like, oh, my God, my dad is going to kill me.
Correct.
You know what I'm saying?
There was a sense of responsibility.
Yeah, exactly.
See, the kids nowadays are going to say, you know, I parked there.
Right.
I was just a minute late.
Right.
I'm the victim. They took it from me.
Yeah.
So things are turned around, and I think we didn't have that. But is the whole patriotic thing, is the whole belonging, is instead of seeing me, 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 and just what I'm feeling,
right.
There's a whole world.
Right.
So even when people talk about the president, our country right now, I tell them, instead of me, 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 look at the employment rate, you know, employment rate on minorities.
Right.
Look at the world.
Right.
Look at where ISIS is disappearing. So there is so many other factors other than, you know, what the media gives you.
Oh, the media has destroyed the media. Well, this is something that I discussed last week. The media had, you know, Jim Acosta with CNN was consistently saying, oh, President Trump said that the media is the enemy of the American people. I think that's true.
I think that's true.
And
nowadays, sadly enough, I think that's true because I don't think they're reporters.
They're not reported. They're biased. They're pushing an agenda. They're pushing
propaganda.
And you can see with this whole alt-right, white supremacist thing that took place today. It was wall-to-wall coverage of this white supremacist thing going on in, oh, well, there's the anniversary, the year of, not anniversary, but it's been a year since Charlottesville.
Correct.
And they're saying, oh my God, the media wall-to-wall coverage of this thing with the alt-right white supremacist. And it's only like 24 folks there. And the media is acting like this is the national crisis of America.
We've been talking about it all week.
Exactly. In fact, Washington Journal last week had on race relations.
Right.
It's like, hello, why are we talking about race relations still?
Right.
That's crazy. You know, that's crazy.
Because gives us a reason not to do what we need to do. But when I talk about the media, I think there's so many positive things to talk about for these kids. There's so much that they could be putting there into other than one little negative aspect of some bad people. Talk about what's happening great in this country, how much better we are, you know, where we are achieving. Even with drug, what you see of the opioid crisis, I always see them showing on TV people overdosing, stories of people using heroin, families destroyed. And I understand that drama creates rates. But with that said, give a solution in the end. So if you have the issue, call this number or show somebody that actually got well.
Mm-hmm.
Give hope to people. Don't just show how
problem,
horrible.
Problem, problem, problem.
That's
how they show problems, problem,
correct.
Problem. No remedy. And when they talk about racism / white supremacy, they never talk about a remedy, how we can solve it. They just say, this is the problem. We're in trouble. And, you know, Dr. Frances Gress Wellesley is the woman who popularized the terms white supremacy. And she had an 18-point list of the things to black folks must do to make it better, but they never discussed that. But when we were off air, you were talking about the 93-year-old woman who was caught at the border.
81-year-old woman.
Tell my listeners
about
that.
Was caught in the border 2 days ago, bringing in almost $1 million worth of heroin.
An 81-year-old
woman.
Tell us more.
And the thing is, because of the borders are getting tighter right now, they're trying everything they can to bring the heroin in. And the more our kids need to self-medicate, the more heroin they're going to use and more ways they will try to invade our borders. So I think we need to protect our borders
By any means we can. You know, that's what Malcolm X said. By any means necessary. That was his meme, so to speak. So we take the position here at the Naked Truth Report that we must protect our borders by any means necessary.
As mothers, we protect our kids at any means.
Yeah.
So if we know they're being offered poison in school, aren't we going to protect the ones that are bringing the poison in?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And how, you know, she was at the border. She was at the San Diego.
81-year-old woman. Two days ago.
This is amazing. And she was coming in from Mexico. But you said she was a U.S. citizen?
She was a U.S. citizen.
What was she thinking? But was she of Mexican heritage or what?
I have no idea.
Did they give her a name or whatever?
I did not see a name in the news. It's just amazing to me. You get desperate people, you know? You get desperate people, and they'll do desperate things.
But our economy is doing better. So why? I don't know why she was desperate. I would, you know, when we finish the show, I'm going to Google that after the show.
You do. And you don't know if they threaten her family that lives in Mexico. You never know.
Yes, stuff like that happens.
Correct.
Yeah. And but, she was sort of, yes, things
now,
like that.
Imagine
happen.
A $1 million worth of heroin. How many kids it wouldn't kill? And forget just the overdose. How many families would not be destroyed by that drug coming in?
$1 million
right.
worth of. Wow. Yeah. I'm going to Google that. I'm sure it was in the L.A. Times. Where did you read that?
In the internet, it was in L.A. Times. If you just put Mexico and heroin the last 2 days, you'll see. Yeah.
Oh, my God. So, yeah. I mean, so, what? You know, another thing that I want to mention is this backstabber, Omarosa, mm-hmm. who has written the book about mm-hmm. Trump. I mean, mm-hmm. she's such a backstabber. At the break, I didn't know if I wanted to play the OJs. Just, they're smiling in your face. You know, that's what is it? They're smiling in your face. I can't think of the next word. But or I didn't know if I wanted to play that, The Backstabbers, if I wanted to play The Big Payback by James Brown. The Big Payback. You know, I mean, because obviously she's trying to seek revenge against the Trump administration, and she's also trying to...
She's trying to be relevant.
Sell books.
She's just trying to make herself relevant because she's not relevant.
She's not relevant. And she's trying to sell books.
Right.
You know, one of the things I said she could have done, she could have written, because she's backstabbing Trump, definitely. She could, but for Trump, we wouldn't know about Omarosa. And she could have written a book about, like, the class and etiquette of being in the White House. And I think Trump supporters would have, just on GP, supported that book and bought it.
She could have do what you do. She could help, you know, people know that there is opportunities out there. With education, you can reach, you know, places. So she could do a lot.
She could do a lot, but she's a negative. I think she's an opportunist, and she's egomaniacal. And, you know, this is going to sound bad, but, you know, she's also a preacher. So, I mean, that sounds terrible, but I mean it. This is how I feel. It's like the black community has been bamboozled, hoodwinked, and pimped by the church. Because it's the responsibility of the black church to inform and to nurture the black community, not just spiritually.
I think it is a responsibility of the church. I think it's the responsibility of teachers. I think it's the responsibility of parents. Is to guide, especially the young kids, to positive paths.
Yeah. Well, you know, I'm glad Trump won.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, I mean, can you imagine how things would be if Trump did not win?
I don't even want to think about it.
I mean, can you imagine Hillary? You know, Hillary betrayed the Green Party, mm-hmm. which is like, you know, those were the liberals, right? And now... If she would have, and yet she betrayed the Green Party, she betrayed Bernie Sanders, but we are supposed to believe she would not betray the Trump administration. By any means necessary to win. She wouldn't do whatever it took to win. She would not set up the Trump administration. And that's what's coming out now with this business about Bruce Orr. Let's see, how does it go exactly? I think that the FBI informed Michael Steele that he, because he had leaked information to the press, that he could no longer be involved, or he was precluded or foreclosed from being involved in this... Or maybe the DOJ informed him, but they informed him that he could not be involved with the FBI could not receive information from Michael Steele anymore.
Yeah, but, they have their own rules.
And so they went behind the back door or underneath or whatever, circumvented Michael Steele, and they went to this Bruce Orr to give the FBI or Peter Strzok information that Michael still had with Fusion GPS. So, you know, there's just so much corruption. There's just so much corruption and so many bad things going on. We would not know any of this if Hillary would have won.
Absolutely. And the opioid crisis, too, would be in a lot worse shape, believe it or not, than it is, because we turn our faces to allow the pharmaceutical companies sell Oxycontin without any limitations or regulations.
So we're speaking with Claire Weissman. Did I pronounce your last
name?
Who it has the Weissman method. We're going to talk about, when we come back from the break, I'm going to have her talk about the Weissman method in a little more detail. This is the Naked Truth Report. I'm your host, Kathleen Wells. And there's the big payback, James Brown. Hey, I love that. I love that. I love that. Because Omarosa is getting the big payback on the Trump administration. But did you know what? The Trump administration is going to get the big payback on Omarosa. Am I right?
Yes.
Okay, when we come back, we'll open up the phone lines. We're going to talk about the Weissman method a little bit, and we open up the phone line so you can ask Claire any question you'd like to ask her, right? And the call-in number is, oh, it's not up on my screen, Jeff, that's okay. But my folks know it. We'll be right back. There's the I love the big payback. I love that song. I dig that, right? We'll be right back. Obviously, Omarosa likes payback, too. She's like revenge on the Trump administration because she didn't get her way like a little spoiled girl, right?
Exactly.
But, you know, the Trump administration, they're winners.
Yep.
Trump is a winner. This isn't going to have an adverse impact on him. I mean, come on. Who can take Omarosa seriously? But that's the only way she's going to make some money to sell some books.
Yep.
You know, because her revenue... her income has been stopped.
Well, without Trump, who really is she?
Yeah. And now she's sort of like sore. She had a bad reputation from the get-go, but, you know, Trump gave her a little more mileage.
Right.
But then she blew it. So now she has to get some payback. So I'm speaking. Hi, this is Kathleen Wells with the whole Naked Truth Report. I'm your host, and I'm speaking with Claire Weissman, who has the Weissman method. For
opioid treatment.
For opioid treatment. Yeah. Tell us about the process a little bit, Claire.
Yeah. What the Weissman method is, we treat opiates only. So it's a very specific treatment program and is medical. So instead of blaming, the last 40 years we have blamed patients for their addictions, and we have locked them in rehabs hoping to teach them a lesson. This has been not just ineffective, but almost cruel. Nowadays, we understand that especially opioid dependence is a medical condition that can be medically treated in the hospital, you know, with anesthesia in a humane manner. And whatever emotional issues that you have that are the root cause of that addiction, the reason that you want to self-medicate, you can treat with a therapist, with a psychiatrist, with whoever that is, while maintaining a productive life in most cases. That is so much more effective than what we've been doing for 40 years. Putting stigma and making people feel like third-class citizens doesn't help anybody.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, during the crack epidemic, I got to mention it, Black Americans, it disproportionately impacted them, mm-hmm. and they became felons. They mm-hmm. went to prison for mm-hmm. being addicted to crack cocaine. So what is your success rate with your treatment method?
For the detoxification, we have nearly 100% because they are in the hospital. They are being treated under sedatives. We manage their vitals. We manage their symptoms, and we get them from A to Z. So people ask us all the time, so what's the long-term success rate? That's the same thing if you ask, you know, a obese patient that had a heart issue, what's your long-term success rate? Patients come to us for opioid dependence. instead of waiting for things to progress and have the social issues that is going to affect them, the families, and everybody around them, we can reverse the dependency, we can get them through the withdrawal, and then we can focus on dealing with the real issue. Addiction is just a consequence. It's not the issue.
Mm-hmm. So what skills or what background do you have that prepares you to deal with this?
Well, I do all the administration. Mm-hmm. I'm actually a counselor. I am a registered specialist in addiction, but all I do is administration. Once the patient is admitted, he's seen by a cardiologist, by anesthesiologist, by psychotherapist. So what I was able to do is put together the best group of professionals to treat every possible aspect of the physiological side of the patient.
Okay, I'm Kathleen Wells, host of the Naked Truth Report. I'm talking to one of my VIP guests at the pre-screening of the Dinesh D'Souza film, Death of a Nation, Claire Weissman. And we're talking about the Weissman method. Now, I'm going to take a phone call. Let's take a phone call from, someone named Anonymous. Hi, Anonymous.
Hi, am I on?
Yeah, you're on. Welcome to the Naked Truth Report.
Thank you so much. I was listening to the young lady that was speaking, and this is for a friend of mine. He keeps on going in and out of rehabs, never finishing and winding back on drugs. So we're just looking to try to really help this person.
Yes, it's actually a very, very common issue that patients can't make through the withdrawal. I don't know if you ever, Kathleen, saw any movies or anything of somebody going through a opioid withdrawal from heroin or methadone. It's brutal. You're vomiting, you're having diarrhea, you're sweating, you feel like your muscles going to crawl out of your skin. And after days of that, they know if they use a little bit, all these symptoms disappear immediately. So as I was telling you, for many years, rehabs believed that if they suffered, they would learn a lesson. Mm-hmm. The suffering keeps them, A, from seeking treatment because they're so scared of it, mm-hmm. and B, they run away because they can't withstand it. Mm-hmm. That is cruelty. Mm-hmm. People should be treated by physicians. You have patients that have high blood pressure, mm-hmm. That can have serious health risks during withdrawal. Mm-hmm. They get dehydrated, mm-hmm. and it's absurd that this is still allowed
so
in this country.
So what do you do different than...
They are admitted to an accredited hospital with physicians. They're going to get them from A to Z.
Uh-huh. And do they give them methadone?
No, methadone is one of the strongest narcotics available.
So what do they do exactly?
They help them to manage the withdrawal. So if they they are able to use medications, mm-hmm. that the withdrawals are minimal.
Oh, I see.
And they're comfortable through it.
Right.
And at the same time, we can check blood pressure, heart rate, keep them hydrated so they don't have any health risks. Uh-huh. We treat patients 80 years of age. Mm-hmm. They had 4 or 5 back surgeries, mm-hmm. and became addicted to Vicodin, to mm-hmm. Percocet, to Oxycontin. Mm-hmm. How do you put, we treat Mary that goes to the church every Sunday, never had a beer in her life. Mm-hmm. Why should she go to a rehab and say, hi, I'm Mary, I'm a drug addict? Mm-hmm. She's not.
I see. So why don't, Claire, give out the phone number so people can contact.
Okay, of course.
Yes, the phone number.
It's 310-205-0808, and your friend can call us, and if we cannot treat them, I have a number of resources based on his specific needs that we'll assess and direct him to the right place.
Well, I really appreciate this. I will definitely let the person know he definitely needs help. And I really appreciate both of your time on this. This is a great subject matter, and it's really important right now on what's going on in this country.
It is. Yes, I am here. And again, even if we cannot help him, I'll be happy to direct him where he can get help.
You sound great. And I appreciate that.
You're very welcome. So, listener, Truth Warriors out there, if you know anyone who's addicted to opiates, they can call 310-205-0808, and they have the Weissman method, and you're going to be checked into a hospital. These folks are here to help, and it's a different method than using methadone or whatever, having withdrawals or so on and so forth. So why don't we take a call from Sarah in Los Angeles. Hi, Sarah. Welcome to the Naked Truth Report.
Hi, how are you?
Good. How are you?
Good. Thank you so much for taking my call.
Hi, Sarah. How are you?
Hi, good. I had a question for Claire Weissman. I was wondering, you see in not only the news, but kind of in pop culture, there's a lot of celebrities partaking, but they're also, you see them dying all the time. And with things like this available, why don't you think they're finding your treatment or looking into this as an option to save them?
Yes, that's a great question, actually. You know, we just saw 3 days ago, in New York, Bethany Frankel's boyfriend passed of an overdose to OxyContin due to pain, back pain. And that's a tragedy. But the problem is society had put such a stigma on addiction that a person like him that is, you know, a high-profile person, a person that takes care of other people's financial well-being, is scared to approach treatment. He is scared for that to get known, and you know, it's like tagged in your forehead, because for the last 40 years, sadly enough, 12-step believed that once an addict, always an addict. The word addict is harmful. This is a condition people are going through. It's not who they are, and it shouldn't dictate what their future will be. They can be treated, and they can be treated for their mental health issues and have a productive life. Listen, depressed people, 40 years ago, what happened? If you were depressed, you would be locked up and fully medicated, and people would hide you from society. The same they do with people with addiction. Nowadays, if you're depressed, you take an antidepressant, you see a therapist, and you're part of society. It's a condition. It does not, you know, it does not mean that this is who you are, and don't allow anybody to convince you otherwise. So that's the reason. What was the name of the caller?
Sarah.
Hi, Sarah. So that's the reason most people, especially, you know, that are in the media and in the public view, do not seek treatment until things happen. We saw Demi Lovato not long ago. So this is somebody that was, again, you know, I'm sober, and she relapsed. And it would be so much easier if she could have gone to her doctor like us and say, you know, I relapsed. Can I please go into the hospital for a few days, and can you reverse this? It's possible. Let's offer people. Now, the other issue is mental health crisis in this country.
Well, you know, I wonder if Kate Spade's suicide or Anthony Bourdain's suicide had anything to do with the depression.
Oh, of course. But that's where I was going. The stigma on addiction and mental health is cruel. It causes destruction of people's lives because they are so scared of saying, I have a mental illness. So what? Anxiety is a mental illness. Depression is a mental illness. And it's all treatable and reversible. And there's nothing to be ashamed of. You know, even with the parents, and Sarah, I'm just giving you more here. Even with some parents sometimes that I speak to, believe it or not, you can say your child has a heroin problem, your child has a cocaine problem, your child has an addiction problem. The moment you say your child has a mental illness, oh, no, he doesn't. You know, the stigma of somebody having a mental illness is detrimental to our society. And it could really solve drug issues, homeless issues, issues with shootings out there, most of these people have mental illness that was not treated.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
We were driving here now, and we saw this man crossing the street, and my husband said, you know, being homeless has to be something so incredibly horrible. And I said to him, most of this could be solved if there was more help for mental illness in this country.
And, well, you know, and I've interviewed Ted Hayes, who deals with the homelessness. He says he's been dealing with this for decades. He said some of the homeless people prefer to be homeless than to deal with the stress of paying bills and having insurance.
They don't have the tools to deal with any stress. That's
right.
Why they self-medicate.
Right, right, right.
And you were talking about the rules, like they want to put all our resources in bathrooms downtown. They're going to become shooting galleries. And I understand there are issues with defecation, mm-hmm. and hepatitis and mm-hmm. all the above. But most of these people have mental illness.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So they don't need a bathroom to walk to. Mm-hmm. You know, they're opening more and more shooting places so they can shoot heroin.
Yeah, like in San Francisco. But so Reagan, I don't even want to talk about it politically, because I don't know it well enough to say something about it. So why don't we take a call now from Bill in Redondo Beach. Hi, Bill. Hi, Bill. Welcome to the Naked Truth Report.
Yes, thank you. Thank you. Having suffered from depression myself and having known people that have overcome addiction problems, I know that it's very important in life to not make where people, first of all, need to be encouraged by other people. The worst thing is for people to be shut out and be made to feel like and rejected, because that only makes them withdrawn in themselves more. And I think these quick fix solutions don't work. I think what you're talking about, doctor, is so important. There's another problem too, and I think this has happened in churches and a lot of places. I think one of the things that makes these things worse in our culture is the loss of manners and the old thing of, hey, how can I help you in some way, the way friends and people used to. I think as we get away from that, and even with the social media, people become very disconnected from one another. People retreat into themselves. They feel like they can't go to anybody and talk to them. So I think it compounds the problem along with all these other various components you're talking with,
No doubt whatsoever. You're absolutely right. The social media has made people not just disconnected with one another, but there's a facade. In the social media, you can be anything you want. So you actually become very insecure of who you really are.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there's also something else, too. I think that there has been I'm going to say this. I'm a baby boomer, but our generation, Dr. Benjamin Spock said something before he died, and he repented of this. He was raised up in a Christian home. He said, I and others like me in the 60s, he was talking about Jerry Rubin, Abby Hoffman, and mm-hmm. so many of the hippies and the others, they promoted this idea, if it feels good, do it. You know, whatever floats your boat.
Mm-hmm. Right,
Ken
that's
Kesey,
true.
You know, this whole thing of, Timothy Leary, tune on, tune in, and drop out. But he said, what we did is we promoted this really horrible idea that doesn't work. It's a failed idea,
mm-hmm.
that you can have liberty with license. And what this does is it creates narcissism and selfishness.
Yeah.
And so when you, and I'll finish up here, but when you go down the streets now and you see the horrible way people drive and the way people
right.
are rude to one another.
Totally.
And the loss of manners in the
yes.
society. See, manners and common courtesy and integrity and character virtues got lumped in with old injustices.
Sorry.
Well, segregation was bad and it was old, so let's get rid of manners because it's old. No.
Right, get rid
of boundaries and standards.
I agree with you.
It creates anarchy.
Have you noticed how people are like rude on the freeway? We used to drive with manners.
Look, I was with a woman and we were victims of road rage.
Okay? Exactly, yeah.
This is terrible. And
you know, in my office,
like firsthand.
When I come out of my garage, if it's a young mm-hmm. person or a young girl, I don't even attempt because I know they're not going to let me. They're just going to cut me off. So I wait for an older person, and they usually will stop and let me go.
Right,
it is amazing.
Right. It's a change in society. They're confused.
Bill is right. He's absolutely
right. You're so
right
about that. I notice on the road, it's like people are crazy.
In the dress
code. You are so rude.
In the dress
code. Let me in.
You go to a nice restaurant,
yeah.
and people come in like they're going to the beach.
Tacky.
And with their pants falling, I don't want to see your underwear. Put your pants up. Put a belt on.
I mean, are we sounding like our parents or what? We're sounding like old folks, I'm thinking. You know what I mean?
Our parents knew what they were doing better than we did.
I know, but now we're like them.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? I don't know.
Because we appreciate them.
We appreciate them.
Yes.
Yeah. Thanks, Bill, for calling in. That was
Thank
an
you,
excellent
Bill.
Comment, Bill. This is the Naked Truth Report. I have my VIP guest with me, Claire Weissman. It's a good thing. We're going to have another VIP guest next week. Can you imagine?
Who's that?
Well, I don't want to say the name. I want to surprise my listeners. They won't know anyway. But I just, she's a VIP guest.
All right.
Okay. Thank you, Claire. I really appreciate you
pleasure.
Being a guest. I really appreciate the fact that you saw the Dinesh D'Souza film,
course.
Death of a Nation, and our pre-screening, which I moderated. It was a good thing.
We got to support each other, right?
I appreciate it.
To make this a better society.
High five.
Yep.
Okay. Thank you for listening. This is the Naked Truth Report. I'm your friendly truth warrior. You guys are my truth warriors and myth busters. And I want to say that next week, I'm going to start my promo on the town hall. We're going to have this big town hall coming on September 16th, and I'd like all my truth warriors and mythbusters to attend. This is an opportunity for us to meet. Yeah. It's exciting. Anyway, thank you. I'll see you next week. This is my love song to my truth warriors who have deep roots in Los Angeles, deep roots in California, and deep roots in America. Go Trump, mega winning. See you next week. Thank you very much.